The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. The story you're about to hear has its origins in historical fact. The bare essentials are on public record. But in the audacious way of dramatists, we have taken the liberty of embellishing, transposing, adding to, and subtracting from the strict truth as handed down to us. We beg your indulgence on the grounds that our prime and only purpose is, as always, to entertain you.
But he is my dearest friend.
He is the love of my life.
My only friend.
The one man in the world for me.
I'd give my life for him.
So would I.
I wish he were dead.
I too.
Our mystery drama, A Feast of Death, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Elspeth Eric and stars Jada Rowland. I'll be back shortly with Act One.
The date of our story is further back than most of us are likely to remember, at least with any clarity. It is 1917, and the First World War is in progress. The place where our story occurs is more familiar. It is Paris. The names of the people involved have been changed to protect the innocent and the guilty. Listen now to the story called A Feast of Death.
Told me you were home. That's why I kept playing.
Oh, what else did the old hag tell you?
Well, nothing. Only that you seem distressed. Are you distressed, Yvette?
Distressed? Yes, I think one might say I am distressed. I am desolated. André, my life is over. I want nothing but to die.
You are unhappy, Yvette?
I tell you I want to die, and you ask me, am I unhappy? Oh, yes. Oh, yes, my dear André. I am unhappy. And I shall never be happy again.
Do you want to tell me why?
I suppose I might as well.
It might make you feel better.
I guess tell you everything. From the beginning. If you want to listen.
Oh, do you, Yvette? Always do you.
I must look right for... I've been crying for hours.
You look beautiful. Beautiful. You never look anything but beautiful to me.
What a good friend you are, André.
I try to be.
A friend to me. And a friend to him.
Oh, where is he, by the way?
They've taken him away. The police came this morning and took him away.
The police? What would the police want with Jacques?
Oh, André, in such a long and sorry story. I'm not sure you want to hear it.
Oh, but I do, I do.
If you insist. He and I met that time I was in the hospital. You remember?
Oh, oui. You were ill with pneumonia, I remember.
Oh, Jacques, used to come to my room every day. At first, I thought he was a doctor. He never said he was, but I thought, why else would he be coming to my room every day? He never asked me how I felt or anything like that, the way doctors do. And after a while, I began to wonder, why all these visits? Why all the concern for the welfare of someone he did not know? You are so good to me. So kind to me. Why?
But why not? You're a lovely young girl.
Paris is full of young girls. Young girls who are not ill. Not helpless. not penniless like myself. Is it goodness? Simple charity?
Well, I could say that it began as an act of charity. You see, Yvette, I make a practice of visiting hospitals. In particular, the wards where the more indigent patients are forced to lie. I've been visiting this hospital for, at least 15 years.
How wonderful of you. How extremely kind. I've never been ill before. I never knew such things went on.
I imagine there are many things in this shabby world you know nothing about.
Well, I'm only 17.
I know. 17 and a seamstress.
How did you know that?
You work 12 hours a day for a couturier near the Étoile. And they pay you very badly. You live in a tiny garret room in Montmartre. It has no heat, no running water. You pay a franc once every 2 weeks for the privilege of taking a bath. You have no proper winter coat, no warm gloves.
How do you know these things?
I've talked to various people. It was not hard.
But why? Why would you take so much trouble for one you scarcely know? A poor seamstress.
Because I love you.
You? You love me? Incredible. Absolutely incredible. That you should love me. A splendid gentleman like you.
I want to take you home with me, Yvette.
Home? You want me?
I have a large apartment in Auteuil. I think you will like it. I think in time you might come to love me. Oh, yes, I'm older than you, of course, more than 20 years older. Still, I am not an old man.
Oh, no. No, not old at all.
I try to keep in shape. I once belonged to the 10th Hussars, you know, long before you were born. I was only 22 at that time, but I've tried to keep in trim.
Oh, you have? Oh, yes.
Is it possible that you might learn to love me a little?
But I do love you.
You do?
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes.
Then, when the doctors say you may leave the hospital, you will come home with me? Is it settled?
Settled? All settled. My dear. Why, I don't even know your name.
Jacques. Call me Jacques.
Jacques. It was so beautiful, André. It was every dream come true. I loved every inch of his beautiful body, which could not have changed much since he was with the 10th Hussars. And his lovely mustache, always perfectly trimmed and waxed.
Ah, yes. Jacques always looked the perfect man about town. Oh, I envy him. I always have. I could never hope to present an appearance even remotely like that. Well, for an apartment like this.
Oh, André. When he brought me back here, to this place, in a limousine, André, a limousine.
Oh, my sweet Yvette.
Before I could do or say anything, Jacques took my arm and led me inside. The foyer. Even before I laid eyes on this apartment. The foyer downstairs. I had only seen one to compare with it. And that had been when I delivered a dress to a duchess. All marble and polished brass. And beautiful plants.
I know. Oh, I know.
I was living in a dream. Moving like a sleepwalker. Jacques led me to the lift with its beautiful iron grillwork. And I felt it rise. As though I were being carried to paradise. And when it stopped, and the door opened, he led me, still dreaming, to this apartment.
Enter, mademoiselle. Well, you like it? You approve? Yvette, you think you can be happy here, with me?
Oh, Jacques.
Now, Now. No tears, my little one.
How can I tell you? How can I thank you?
Here, take my handkerchief.
That you should do all this for me?
Dry your eyes.
I don't deserve such kindness, such luxury.
You deserve much more, and you shall have it. Now, let me show you your new home. Through that window, you can see the Eiffel Tower.
Oh, it's too much, too much.
All the furniture is Louis XVI, all genuine. If you should want to change anything...
Oh, no. It's all too perfect.
Through there, you can see the dining room. The butler's pantry is beyond. And, of course, the kitchen. Now, let me show you your bedroom.
Oh, wait. What's that over the mantel?
That? Oh, that's my old sword. From the time I spent in the 10th Hussars. I keep it for sentimental reasons. Memento of my youth. Come, I want you to see the bedroom down the hall. Here we are.
Oh, how lovely.
You like it?
It's all white. Everything is white. The walls, the rug, the beds, the chest.
French provincial.
The curtains. Swiss embroidery.
A tambour, I believe it's called.
All done by hand, all this embroidery. Oh, look here. A pull thread. I'll fix that.
No need to bother.
Oh, but I want to. After all, I'm a seamstress. I want to do something. You're doing so much for me. I'll buy the finest thread.
Later, much later, when you're settled in. Now I must show you the kitchen. It has a warming oven. Come and see.
I can't believe what's happening to me.
This way. Yvette. This way. Come.
Is that another room at the end of the hall?
Yes. But you wouldn't be interested.
Of course I'd be interested. May I see it?
If you insist. It's my laboratory.
Your laboratory?
I'm only an amateur toxicologist. There. Look, if you like.
Oh, my. It's scary, isn't it?
Not at all. At least not if you know what you're doing.
What are you doing, Jack? All those test tubes and things, what are they for?
Shall I tell you, my darling? Shall I tell you my profound secret?
If you want to.
If we are to live together, you should know.
Then tell me.
You must promise never to breathe a word to anyone.
I promise.
If I succeed, and I firmly believe I shall succeed, it will make me famous as a scientist and as a patriot.
Tell me, Jacques. Tell me.
I am on the very brink, Yvette, of a great discovery. Poison gas. A new and deadly poison gas. One against which the filthy Boche have no defense. One which will end the war within a week, a day, an hour.
And it was all lies, all of it. Start to finish, all lies. He had no intention of inventing a poison gas. He was no scientist. He was no patriot. He was a greedy, selfish, egotistical maniac. He did not love his country. He did not love his friends, not even you, André, though you may have thought he did.
Well, he often told me so.
Lies. He loved no one but his own vicious, conniving self. He was incapable of truth. He lied to live. He lived to lie.
Oh, it's hard to believe.
You'll believe it when I told you the rest.
Though there's one thing that could almost persuade me.
Wait till I tell you.
That Jacques was with the 10th Hussars. That's true enough. But he was no hero. To speak candidly, he was discharged from the 10th Hussars. Dishonorably discharged. Among other things, for cowardice.
Thus far, we have learned that Jacques is a liar. Or to phrase it more genteelly, a prevaricator. But hasn't each one of us been guilty of this minor sin at one time or another? It seems a very tiny transgression, hardly one to send his sweetheart into such transports of grief and despair. But she has promised to tell more. And in Act Two, she will. That the mysterious Bourvardier who has seduced our lovely young heroine did not always tell the truth. We know that he has been hauled off by the police. We know that his close friend of many years is attempting, however clumsily, to comfort the bereft girl. What we do not know is the entire reason for his solicitude and her agonized grief.
Lies! Lies! Nothing but lies! You have not heard the worst. His schemes, his intrigue, his deviltry. You have not heard about Danielle.
You know about Danielle?
Know about her. She was my friend. My good, close friend. The older woman I could confide in, get advice from. Almost like a mother to me.
You know that Danielle was once Jacques' mistress?
That was difficult at first. I had great pangs of jealousy. But, after all, Jacques was 42 when our liaison began. I was 17. How could I hope or expect that I might be the first woman in his life? No, that would be too much. Still, we were happy together for a year. And then...
Yvette, my darling, there is something I must talk to you about.
Yes, my love.
You know, since I've started my little business with Monsieur Grandet...
The bicycle shop?
Yes, a toy, a plaything. I shall never get rich from it, but...
But we already have enough money, haven't we?
Oh, enough. But the bicycle shop amuses me. I enjoy it. And Grandet does a good job. Oh, good enough, anyway.
Could I meet him sometime?
Meet Grandet? Oh, my dear child, the man is a great oaf, a boor.
But if he's your partner...
A business arrangement, purely. No need to meet him socially. But there is someone I should like you to meet socially. Someone you should come to know. I think you and she will get along. And since the bicycle shop is taking up more and more of my time... She'll be company for you. I don't want you to become bored with your life. You might leave me and break my heart.
Who is this woman, Jacques, that you have selected to be my friend?
Her name is Danielle. She's older than you are, younger than I am. A woman of the world.
Will she like me?
She will adore you, even as I do. You'll see. I expect her any minute.
Here? She's coming here?
Where else would you meet?
We never have guests of any kind. Do I look all right? Is my dress all right? Should I...
There she is. Yes, my dear, your dress is quite perfect, and you look like an angel.
Jacques.
Danielle. You look ravishing, my dear. Come in, come in. Danielle, this is my adorable Yvette. Yvette, this is my dear friend, Danielle.
Chérie, you are every bit as pretty as Jacques said.
He's told you about me?
But of course, he talks of nothing but you.
I didn't know.
Now, you two are to become close friends. I've set my heart on it. I'm going to absent myself while you get acquainted. If you need me, I shall be in my laboratory. But I fancy I will not be needed.
Does he still have that smelly old laboratory?
You know about it.
Oh, sweet child. I was once the mistress of this house.
Of course. I wasn't thinking.
Have I upset you? My dear, it was years ago. He hasn't given me a thought except in the most casual way since we parted. Now he has this idea that you and I should meet and talk and come to know each other. Like each other.
And be friends. I'd like that. I don't have a woman friend. I think I need one.
Then you must let me fill that need. Oh, we will have great times together. We will shop for clothes, and we'll gossip and exchange recipes, and perhaps...
Yes, perhaps.
I think Jacques has other plans for us, ambitious ones, if we find we are compatible. So, let us talk, shall we? You must begin. Tell me everything about you.
I liked her. Oh, I liked her so much, Andre.
Splendid woman, very sympathetic.
She must have liked me, because she called me the very next day and asked me to lunch with her. Andre, no one had ever called me. No one had ever asked to see me, to lunch with me. No one had ever wanted my company.
Oh, dear Yvette.
That anyone should wish to spend time with me. To talk to me. Me alone without Jacques. Just me.
Over here, Yvette.
Oh, Daniel, am I late?
No, no, not at all. I came early to be sure we got a quiet table.
I brought you something.
Oh? Ah, chocolates. My favorites. How did you know?
I didn't. It was Jacques' idea.
He remembered. Oh, I haven't hurt you, have I? It was all so long ago.
It's all right. Really, it's quite all right. I must learn to be more a woman of the world. Like you. Jacques says so.
Take my advice. Stay as innocent as you are. Together, we shall make quite a pair.
Is it really possible that we'll be friends?
But we are friends. Do you not feel it? I do.
I think I do, too.
And soon, we shall be not only friends, but partners.
Partners? You and I, partners?
The boutique. Well, as Jacques not told you, he left it up to me.
Oh, I don't know anything about a boutique.
Ah, but I do. Now, you are a seamstress, am I right?
I was a seamstress until...
Until you met Jacques. I quite understand. But you haven't forgotten how to sew, have you?
Oh, no. Once you know how, you never forget.
Exactly. It's Jacques' idea that you and I should set up a little boutique, very chic, very sophisticated. I will run the front of the shop, and you will take care of the back. Oh, we will have a few exquisite gowns, peignoirs, and such fine underthings of batiste with real lace.
Oh, it sounds beautiful.
Oh, it does, doesn't it? It will give you something to do with your spare time, and I... Well, I'll confess to you, I can use a little spare cash. So, what do you say? Shall we become partners?
It was unbelievable. I was moving out into the world, a little way at least. Now and then, Danielle let me serve a customer in the front of the shop, and I learned a little how to talk to people, how to be at ease with them. I, who had been a stranger on this earth, I was becoming a part of it.
If things go on like this, you will be independently wealthy, Yvette. You will have a comfortable income.
Oh, I'm not interested in the money.
You will have enough to be independent of me.
Now you're teasing.
Very well. I'll be serious. I think you should take out insurance.
Insurance? What sort of insurance? What do I need with insurance?
Suppose something were to happen to Danielle.
What could possibly happen to Danielle?
Who knows? Life is full of uncertainty. Were Daniel to, say, become incapacitated, have an accident, suppose she were to die?
Jacques, how can you think of such things?
Oh, you're such a child, Yvette. You know so little of life.
I'm learning. I'm trying to learn.
The nasty little tricks life can play on us. Now, if Daniel were to be taken away, what would happen to the boutique?
Nothing will happen to Danielle.
You could hardly conduct the business by yourself.
Nothing will happen to her.
How wonderful. The eternal optimism of the very young. So touching, so very touching. But, my love, consider what happened to poor Grandet.
Grandet? From the bicycle shop. Your partner. What happened to him?
Didn't I tell you? He died. Quite suddenly.
You didn't tell me. How? How did he die?
An embolism, I believe Dr. Sorel said, following an attack of typhoid fever.
How could you have forgotten to tell me, the poor man?
No, he was a person of no account, but very valuable to me since he had all the mechanical knowledge I lack. I shall have to give up the bicycle shop. There will never be another Grandet.
Did he have a wife, children?
Oh, you know, I never thought to ask. I must try to find out and do what I can for them. Fortunately, I am able to give them a tidy little sum of money. And all my suite because I was foresighted enough to insure poor Grandet's life for a substantial sum.
You? You had insurance on Grandet's life?
Of course. It's customary when one's financial security depends on another person. It's always done.
I never knew.
And that is why you must insure the life of Daniel. Tomorrow you call André. He's a dealer in insurance, among other things. He'll do it for you.
Oh, Jacques, I can't.
Yvette, you must. Make yourself the beneficiary and insure her for a good, substantial sum.
Oh, Jacques, I can't.
Yvette, you must.
I couldn't do it, André.
Of course you couldn't.
Daniel was like a mother to me. The business arrangement we had, it was lovely. Next to Jacques, Daniel was the most important person in my life.
Was? You said she was the most important?
Don't you know? Haven't you heard?
Heard what?
Daniel is dead.
Daniel? Dead? But why didn't I know? Why didn't anyone tell me?
I thought Jacques would...
But how did it happen?
The epidemic. The influenza, she died of it.
Oh, Yvette. Perhaps this is not the time to mention it, but I don't know how you will take it. Perhaps I should not tell you.
Oh, for heaven's sake, André.
Danielle's life was insured. And you, Yvette, are a very wealthy woman.
And so the mundane motif of insurance has worked its way into our simple story of love. Some form of insurance was known as early as 4000 B.C. to the merchants of Babylon. It was practiced by the Hindus 2,400 years later and by the Greeks 200 years after that. But these contracts were to insure property, not lives. Quite a different matter. I'll be back shortly with our final act. The practice of insuring lives is less than 300 years old. Companies sprang up like flowers in spring and faded with the first frost. The first fumbling attempt to bring order into chaos was in 1762, and it started in England. But to this day, practices vary from country to country. The locale of our story is France, the time early in our own century. Now, the final act of A Feast of Death.
I? a wealthy woman.
Danielle's life was insured for a large sum, Yvette, and you are the beneficiary.
But I never did it. I never insured Danielle's life.
But Jacques did.
Jacques? Oh, I can't believe it, Jacques. Why did he never tell me?
For fear that you might think it too mercenary.
No. It was because he never told me the truth about anything.
But it was the prudent thing to do, after all.
Wait, André, I have not told you what happened this morning. When the police arrived, Jacques and I were having breakfast when this gendarme entered. He identified himself and then... Oh, then...
I shall have to ask you to come with me to headquarters, monsieur. We have a few questions to ask you.
About what, in heaven's name?
Louis Grandet was your business partner, I believe.
A small enterprise, insignificant, a bicycle shop.
Not quite so. The police would like to question you, if you will be so kind as to come with me.
Yes, but I am not dressed. I will have to change my clothes.
I will wait.
Darling, it's all a stupid mistake. Don't worry for an instant. I'll be back before you have time to miss me.
Monsieur Grandet died of typhoid fever.
An embolism following an attack of typhoid, yes. So the doctor's certificate indicated. You have a charming apartment here, madame. Could I look around? By your permission?
Why?
Thank you. Oh, there's a dining room, I see.
The butler's pantry is beyond, then the kitchen.
The soil, bedroom, I suppose?
Jacques is dressing. We shouldn't.
And the door at the end of the hall, another bedroom?
No, that's my...
Yes. You started to say...
Nothing.
Well, surely you are about to say something. You were going to tell me about the room at the end of the hall, no? Am I right? Madame, I am waiting.
It's a secret.
A secret? But you cannot keep secrets from the authorities, madame. We always find them out. Come now. Tell me about the room at the end of the hall.
It's his laboratory?
His laboratory. And what is the purpose of this laboratory?
He is working on a great discovery for the winning of the war. Jacques is a great patriot, monsieur.
Oh, and what is this great discovery?
I can't tell you. I promised I would never tell anyone.
Well, forgive me if I insist. We shall find out sooner or later, madame. So tell me now, what is it?
Poison gas.
Poison gas, huh?
A deadly gas. The Germans will have no defense against it. The war will end in a day, in an hour.
You won't object if I have a look around this laboratory.
Oh, I don't think Jacques would have liked...
Never mind about Jacques.
But I should tell him that...
You will tell him nothing? So, this is his laboratory.
He wouldn't approve of my letting you crawl around in here.
I'm not interested in his approval or disapproval.
He'll be angry.
Let him...
You don't know how he can be when he's angry.
What a lot of stuff he has here.
He's been working for years.
Oh, has he? On his great discovery?
Oh, other things too, I suppose.
Like what? What sort of things?
He never said. Various things.
Various things, huh?
He's an amateur toxicologist, you know.
No, I did not know.
That's what he told me when we first met. You see, I was ill in the hospital.
Hospital, huh?
Jacques was a volunteer there. He came every day to cheer up the patients, comfort them.
Interesting.
That's where we fell in love, Jacques and I.
Madame, I am going to take some of these flasks with me.
Oh, you mustn't.
But I must.
Jacques would be terribly upset.
I'm afraid we must risk that.
But you could be ruining his entire experiment.
I don't think so.
His great discovery, the poison gas.
It can't be.
To end the war.
Madame, listen to me. Now listen carefully. There is nothing in this laboratory that could conceivably end the war. Or even shorten it.
You don't know that.
I assure you. What has been taking place in this laboratory has had nothing to do with that deadly gas to be used against the Boche.
But he told me...
He told you a lie, madame. He is not a man to be trusted.
He wouldn't...
But he did. Now, shall we go and see if he is finished dressing?
Now you see, Andre, why I've been crying. If he had lied to me about the great discovery, he could have lied to me about anything. Everything. Even about loving me.
Oh, my poor darling.
What's that?
Someone's at the door.
Jacques! Could it be Jacques?
Possibly. Shall I go and see?
Oh, would you, André? Oh, I need to fix my face and comb my hair. If it's Jacques...
I'll go to the door while you make yourself beautiful for him.
Oh, everything's all right. Jacques said he'd come back. He only wanted to ask him a few questions about Grande. He told me he'd be back shortly, and now he is. Oh, and everything will be as it was before. How terrible of me to have doubted him. I'm so ashamed. Jacques would never do it.
It's not Jacques.
Not Jacques?
It's the police.
Not Jacques?
Just a member of the police.
Oh. We'll ask him to come in, please, André.
Sir, madame will receive you.
Extremely sorry to disturb you again, madame.
Oh. You were here this morning?
Yes, madame.
Where is... I thought he might be with you. He said he'd return. I was hoping.
I'm afraid it will be some time before he returns, madame.
But why? A little liar, a little misunderstanding.
I'm afraid the matter's a bit more serious than that. We've had our suspicions of him for quite some time, madame. A period of years. He has been engaged in a number of enterprises. One 20 years ago with a man named Houton, who died suddenly of diphtheria. He had been heavily insured by his associate.
Jacques?
The same. We had nothing definite to go on until the death of Monsieur Grande.
Grande died of typhoid fever, an embolism.
Hmm. He seemed on the way to recovery, the doctor tells us, when suddenly he died. His family asked for an autopsy, which our examiner performed, and he found a tiny injection in Grande's thigh, which the doctor vehemently disclaimed, and further examination revealed enough typhus germs in the poor man's body to kill 10 people.
Do you mean that Jacques administered the injection?
We have the doctor's word that he visited Grande at the hospital just at the time when the poor man seemed to be recovering.
You don't need to tell me. I know Jacques had insurance on Grande. He told me so when he urged me to...
Yes, madame. He urged you to do what?
To insure Daniel's life for a large sum. Last week, Daniel died of influenza.
Madame, when I intruded so rudely on the laboratory and confiscated as many flasks as I could carry, among them we found cultures of the typhoid bacilli, cultures of the diphtheria germ. Now it seems we must continue the search to find cultures of the influenza virus.
It is too awful and too hideous to believe.
Are you able to come to headquarters to tell us what you know? Or would you rather wait till tomorrow, perhaps?
Let her wait. She is in no condition.
I quite understand. I'll leave and let your friend take care of you. Till tomorrow, then. Or the day after.
Oh, André. André. My life is in ruins.
Oh, you are so pale.
I feel ill.
Do you have pain?
A little. But it will pass.
Yvette, your legs, look at them. They are swollen.
Oh, yes. Painful, too. André, what does it mean? Am I ill?
Yvette, I must tell you something. Jacques insured your life.
Jacques insured my life? How? Why?
He told me it was against the loss of your love and affection, and I believed him.
You think he's poisoned me?
You are wealthy now, since Danielle's death. I am calling the doctor.
Dr. Sorel, his number is right by the telephone.
Don't worry, my dear. We'll soon know.
Your number, please?
034848.
One moment, please. I will try to reach your number.
She's ringing the doctor. Don't worry, my love. How are you feeling now?
Not well. Not well at all.
Yvette, you know what has just occurred to me? Jacques may have taken out insurance on my life.
Oh, no, André.
Why not? It was his whole career. Living off the lives of others. Collecting on their deaths.
Dr. Sorel here.
Doctor, this is an emergency. A young woman is very ill. We have reason to think she's been poisoned. And a man, too. Myself. I am beginning to feel not at all well. Doctor, can you come at once?
And that, with some additions, is the true story of a villain who lived in the first quarter of our century. Inquiries resulted in his arrest on August 21st, 1918. His trial was set for May of 1921. Yes, there were delays in those times, too, even as now. I'll be back shortly to fill you in on what happened at his trial. A brief footnote to our story. There is little doubt that Jacques would have been found guilty, but we shall never know. In prison, he managed to procure a culture of germs and swallowed them. You might say he died in a way that was most appropriate when you consider the way he lived. Our cast included Jada Rowland, Bob Dryden, Joan Lovejoy, and Ray Owens. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.